evening, everyone, and welcome to Monday Night Travel with Rick Steves Europe. I'm Lisa Friend, and I'm delighted to be your moderator this evening as we stow away in Rick's rucksack to Germany. So please, put your travel dreams in the upright and locked position as I have the pleasure to introduce our tour guide for the evening, Rick Steves. Hey, Rick.
Lisa, thank you for the introduction, and thanks to everybody for joining us on episode number 62 of Monday Night Travel. It has been so much fun to be with you every Monday. I look forward to it. I open my virtual door and a couple of thousand people come rampaging into my living room here, and you are more than welcome because this is our weekly chance to get together and enthuse about travel, to share our passion for travel. I always believe that we're all in the same traveler's school of hard knocks, and it's okay to share notes. I make a lot of mistakes, I take a lot of careful notes, and I organize the lessons from that travel experience so others can learn from my experience rather than their own and have a better trip. Today, we're going to celebrate Germany, and I've put together about it's a different kind of a Monday Night Travel. I've just put together about 10 little clips, fun little, you know, iPhone videos for my Facebook page, fun little segments from our TV production, and three different little slideshows that are PowerPoints to share with you the most impactful hour of information that I can on Germany. So thank you so much for joining us. I hope you've got some appropriate beverage and some culturally tuned in munchies. I've got my big radishes here. I've been so busy, I didn't even get a chance to cut them up into that little spiral you get, you know, when you go to the beer hall. But I love those radishes. So I've got some little ones that are all cut up like here on my favorite toothpicks. And I've got some gummy bears. We're going to be enjoying a few gummy bears later on. But right now, it's most important that we get right into our travels. Before we do, I do want to take a moment to just all of us be in solidarity with the people of Ukraine. It is just a tragedy. It is one of the worst tragedies in our lifetime, what's unfolding right now for this 44 million people in the Ukraine. And we, in our hearts and our prayers, are with you. The courageous stand for freedom and for this beautiful country against the tyranny of Putin. I say Putin because I really don't think it's the Russians. I feel sorry for the Russians too. They've just got themselves a dictator who is a megalomaniac that doesn't understand the humanity of this. Are we still traveling? Of course, we're still traveling. It is, you know, Ukraine, Kiev's about 1,000 miles from Munich. And there's been problems coming and going in Europe forever. And we keep traveling because we need to understand each other. Travel, the way we like to travel, is a powerful force for peace. We've got groups over there. Right now, I'm heading off to Europe in a week. And it's more important than ever that we get to know our neighbors and that we all realize we're a family of nations and we've got to understand each other. Okay, so thank you again for joining us. And right now I want to start with a little bit of Oktoberfest. And when we think about Oktoberfest, it's basically the best beer party in all of Europe, okay? And I'll talk to you about my beer in just a minute, but right now I want to get right into this Oktoberfest. I'm just grabbing my phone and trying to capture the energy here as we're in one of, I think, 8 or 9 tents, each with thousands of people, thousands of slabs of beef and pork and giant beers and huge radishes and giant pretzels and people having so much fun. And I just had to capture the moment. Excuse me, I'm a little bit, well, the beers are big, put it that way. And for some reason, they started filming me when I had my mouth full of pork knuckle, but I can't complain because I was the photographer. So here we go. We're going to go dropping in on a tent at Oktoberfest.
We're having an incredible time, and we're eating pork knuckle. Check this out.
Look at that guy dancing on his bench behind me here. Everywhere you look, there's people standing on their tables and their benches. A few minutes later, I looked down at my port knuckles and there was big boots right next to him. Somebody was standing on my table dancing.
I love Oktoberfest. I love Oktoberfest.
There's Simon, our producer. We've had a good day of filming. You know, I'm not a big party animal in Europe, but if I'm anywhere near striking distance Oktoberfest, I'm not going to miss it. It is a lot of fun. And this crowd is locals. It's not tourists. And tourists are very welcome, but it's locals. Now we're going to go out into the amusement park. Remember, it's a big fairgrounds. There's these big tents, but there's also acres and acres of rides. And a lot of them are historic. One of the most venerable is over 100 years old. It's called the Devil's Wheel. And the Germans invented that whole concept, I think, of schadenfreude and enjoying other people's troubles or pain. And you're going to see this example of schadenfreude as people pay to get in and watch people get thrown off of this wheel. I'm joining you just after about a dozen people who are on here in a big wild rumpus have been thrown from this spinning wheel. It's down to the last three. The wheel goes faster. They start to slide this big wrecking ball in here. They throw a rope in to tangle up in the people. It is quite an experience. Check this out. So they're going to throw a rope in there, and pretty soon one guy's going to flip out, and then you've got the winner. And there is your winner. That's Oktoberfest fun. Hey, right now I want to take you to a little slideshow here. We're going to go to Hamburg, Berlin, and Dresden. And I just want to share with you some of my favorite tips about visiting these wonderful destinations. I do want to remind you, everything is in my Germany guidebook. And this is, how many pages is this thing? 1,150 pages of information. I'm heading over next week to visit 10 different cities, 3 days in each city, updating with all my other guidebook writers and so on, so we can be sure this information is right up to date as we come up with our post-pandemic guidebooks. Hamburg is a city a lot of Americans don't think about going to, but it is the gateway. It's the biggest port in Germany, and it is a fascinating city. Of course, it was really slammed in World War II, rebuilt since. And when we think about Hamburg, it's on a river, and it is a city that has a huge shipping heritage, giant wharf district, all these warehouses that have been derelict, but now they've got this big building product that turned a third of the city in from a industrial wasteland to a modern, high-tech, comfortable place to call home. This is their Elbphilharmonie, their striking new concert hall, right there on the river of the city. Germans know this station here as the springboard from where literally millions of Germans emigrated. So many Germans came to the United States. This was generally their last look at their home country as they got on a ship here and sailed across the Atlantic. If you are interested in harbor tours, the best harbor tour anywhere in Europe, I find, is in Hamburg. And to give you an idea of how many English-speaking tourists are or are not in Hamburg, as I was researching my guidebook, it occurred to me there was three or four different companies doing these harbor tours, and there was only one English-speaking tour a day. Not many English-speaking tourists are in Hamburg. It's very popular with the Germans. This is Berlin now, and this is the Potsdamer Platz. This was the ground zero of Berlin. This is where their busiest square in Europe was before the war. And then it was a no man's land with the Berlin Wall cutting right across there. And then in the last 50 years, of course, it's been built up. It's a modern office park. And if you know where to look down, you'll see a monument that says in the pavement where the Berlin Wall stood from 1961 to 1989. In the old days, you didn't even concern yourself with the river. The Spree River was the border. It had barbed wire in it. If you swam across it, they would shoot you. Today, the Spree River is a resort. It's just everybody's on lounge chairs enjoying a beer in the sunshine in the summer. And Berlin has a wonderful ambiance, a wonderful love of life in a kind of a northern kind of way, as opposed to Bavaria. But there's wonderful ruined, sort of elegantly run down places in the bombed out and formerly decrepit eastern part called Prince Lauenberg. Here we have rustic, creative little businesses that just do a wonderful job of helping people have a good time. You know, the wall cut Berlin in half. And today, the wall, the people go to where the wall was just to kind of dance on its ruins. I mean, the biggest park is the Mauerberg, or the Mauer Park and the Wall Park. And on a sunny afternoon in the summer, this is where everybody gathers. Right there in the Wall Park, they've got a huge karaoke stage and people take turns entertaining 1,000 people. Talk about karaoke fun. In Berlin, you've got a lot of historic buildings that now, instead of parking lots, have parks in front of them. And amazing museums, amazing governmental buildings. This is the Reichstag. The Reichstag, of course, was bombed out or burned in the part of the rise of Hitler. And then it sat as a bombed out, blackened hulk of the former government throughout the Cold War. And the last days of World War II were literally fought on the rooftop of that building, Germans fighting Russians. And after the end of the Cold War and the fall of the wall, Germany was reunited. It needed its own head of government again in Berlin, not in Bonn. Rather than tearing down the old German building, the old German Congress building, they decided to renovate it and incorporate into it a beautiful glass dome. We're going to climb to the top of that dome later on in the Monday Night Travel episode here. But look at that beautiful architecture. This is designed for Germans to celebrate their democracy. Such a great opportunity to go there with Germans and to see how far they've come and how they are now leaders in democracy in Europe. In front of the Reichstag is a memorial. Each one of these slabs is a congressperson, the equivalent of our senators and representatives, who ended up, when Hitler took power, being sent to concentration camps and then being murdered. Can you imagine if some far right-wing government or far left-wing government took over in our country and people who didn't fall into line were arrested, taken to prisons or concentration camps, and then eventually executed? It happened in Nazi Germany, it happens in Putin's Russia, and it could happen anywhere if a society is not careful. But this is a chilling memorial to people who stood up for democracy when Hitler took over their country, turning that huge democracy into a nightmare. This is the chancellery where the president lives. This is the Brandenburg Gate, used to be in the middle of no man's land in the wall. Today it's a celebration of life. There's the most expensive and important piece of real estate in the city, I think, right next to the Brandenburg Gate, that now is dedicated to the memorial to the murdered Jews. The Germans actually called this the memorial to the murdered Jews, acknowledging that, yes, they murdered 6 million people. And today, when you go there, it's a poignant and powerful memorial. I'll remind you, when you go to Berlin, make time for the memorials. There's many memorials all over town to memorialize their powerful history. Here we have a memorial to the Gestapo and the SS. When you walk there, you learn about the horrors of a police state in the bombed out footprint of their headquarters building. You learn about what it was like when a society decides to burn all the books. I just can't tell you. If that doesn't trouble you to look at the happiness on people's face as they're burning their own books, what kind of a cult is this? These people were led astray by a megalomaniac, charismatic, narcissistic dictator, and they paid the price. This is the only great building surviving from Hitler's government. It's the former headquarters of the Luftwaffe, the Air Force of the Nazis. And today it's a beautiful example of Nazi architecture. And you can see that if you know where to look. For 50 years, Germany was not fascist, but communist. And they had their own propaganda art. And you see that around town if you know where to look. Of course, during communism, it celebrates the workers. Everybody is complacent. Everybody is smiling. Everybody is in lockstep. Nobody questions the government. Powerful, what art that's called social realism. This is the biggest stretch of the wall that survives. And this is a museum now, a fascinating museum, the Museum of the Wall. Checkpoint Charlie is one of the most popular sites in town. It's the Museum of the Wall at Checkpoint Charlie. Checkpoint Charlie is famous with Americans because that was the American-run checkpoint. The Museum of the Wall is just a fascinating place to spend a few hours. A couple hours south of Berlin, you get to Dresden. And Dresden was the capital of a country called Saxony. And it's important to remember that before 1870, there was no Germany. There was all these German-speaking countries that envisioned a grand German-speaking power. And the big question was, who would that be under? Would it be under Prussia? Would it be under Bavaria? Or would it be under a confederation of German states led by Frankfurt? Nobody knew, but Prussia, with its brilliant leader, Bismarck, ended up uniting Germany around 1870 under Prussia. When we go to Dresden, we're seeing the capital of Saxony, and it's a city that was experienced a firebomb. It was bombed so heavily that it created its own climate and sucked everything into it. And tens of thousands of people died almost instantly, and the buildings were just blackened. But today, it's a city that celebrates its heritage. It's got great palaces, great museums, and heartbreaking memorials. Here we see on the night from the 13th to the 14th of February, 1945, just a couple months before the war was over, there was a firestorm created by incredible bombardment, and you know, half of the city was destroyed. This is the famous Frauenkirche Church, and it fell down. And for decades, in an international effort, they rebuilt the Frauenkirche, the beloved Frauenkirche, beloved to the people of Dresden. And today when you go inside, you see the cross that once stood on its top, all blackened and bent because of the fire and the bomb. But it's just a symbol for the resilience of the people of Dresden. We'll go to Rothenburg in just a bit, but right now I want to just kind of go back to a little more of our clips. And when we travel, we find, actually, before we do that, I'm going to have a drink. Prost. Skål. Oh, baby. Yeah. I'm drinking Hefeweizen. And Hefeweizen is a wheat beer. When you go to a beer hall or anywhere in Germany, usually there's three general choices. You've got light beer. That would be Helles. That'd be your basic Pilsner or lager. You've got dark beer, and that would be Dunkel. And then you've got wheat beer. And this wheat beer is, it's sweeter, it's carbonated, it's fruitier. And a lot of people love it. There's entire beer halls in Munich that are dedicated just to wheat beer. So give that a try as you're traveling. Also, I don't have a lot of food tonight because I'm going to Europe in a week. I'm going for 6 weeks, and I'm just kind of going crazy getting ready. But I did open up a little package of gummy bears. And I wanted to celebrate gummies because gummies are a $2 billion business in Germany. That's a lot of little gumdrops, I'll tell you. And gummies were first made in 1922. Happens to be 100 years ago. Happy 100th birthday, gummy bears. Tourists love gummy bears. They're made in Germany in a big factory near the former capital of Bonn. Okay, now, I guess that's all I want to talk about with my food. I'm loving my beer, and I'm eating my gummy bear dutifully, and I'm just looking at my giant radishes, wishing I had a beer hall to get a plate of it, all spiraled like this, boing, 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 nice salt on it. It's a beautiful thing to compliment your beer, I'll tell you that. Everybody is dealing with climate change. In the United States, we're sort of saying, yeah, it's going to ruin the world, but we need to take care of our coal miners in West Virginia, so let's not deal with it, honestly. In Europe, they're realizing if the United States doesn't get on board with climate change, nobody else is going to, because we are the leader of the world that way, and we are not leading. We're not even following. So Germany is just making higher dikes. Holland is making higher dikes. England is building storm surge barriers and little floodgates so that in the high water, things don't inundate their cities like we've had New York and New Orleans inundated. I was just in Hamburg, and Hamburg is along a beautiful river, and they have had to build up the banks of the river, and it's just not an ugly bank. I was in Cairo a couple of years ago, and they just got a beautiful, not Cairo, Alexandria in Egypt on the Mediterranean shore. Alexandria is such a beautiful town, beautiful promenade along the coast. They just don't have the money to build up a beautiful landscaped higher levee. So they just stack up concrete blocks and it's just ugly, but they're not going to get flooded. It's heartbreaking. Here we are in a rich city, Hamburg, and I'm walking on landscaped flood barriers. And I just wanted to capture this for you. So let me take you there with the help of one of our little video clips. And you can think about climate change and why on earth we would ever vote for a politician that doesn't prioritize on dealing with climate change honestly. Sorry, this befuddles me. Why we can't handle a little bit of investment in fighting climate change in this country. Hi, I'm Rick Steves. I'm in Hamburg, and what a beautiful city. Hamburg, mighty port, the biggest port in Germany, huge investment. This is their new Elbphilharmonie concert hall. And I'm standing on an embankment, and they've made 60 miles of designer embankments, giving this city safety in anticipation of storm surges. It's got a 13-foot tide, but more and more and mightier and more expensive storm surges are going to be hitting this city. And with all of that investment, they don't want a big flood like we've had in New York or New Orleans. And look right here, they've got walls that can be brought over. They've got 60 miles of this gear in anticipation of high water. Pretty smart. We're learning from our travels. From Hamburg in Germany. Auf Wiedersehen. Forgive me, but it saddens me that we're not able to rein in climate change with a little smart investment in changing our consuming habits. You may be thinking, but wait a minute, Rick Steves, you lead tourists to Europe. Aren't you part of the problem? Yes, I am part of the problem. And what we want to do as a company is invest in ways to mitigate the carbon we create by taking to Europe so people can go to Europe and back carbon neutral. I want to explain to you my Climate Smart Initiative. It's nothing to brag about. It's nothing heroic. It is simply ethical. If you're a tour organizer like me, you should pay the carbon costs of the travelers you take wherever you take them. It costs $30 smartly invested to mitigate the carbon you or I would create by flying to Europe and back from the United States. $30. In 2019, we took 30,000 people to Europe on our tours, 30,000. I made $900,000 too much, except I gave myself a self-imposed carbon tax of $1 million, and we invested an average of $100,000 in each of 10 companies working to help farmers in the developing world do their work while contributing less to climate change, thus mitigating the climate, the carbon that the 30,000 people who took a Rick Steves tour in 2019 added to the environment. Again, nothing to brag about, it's simply ethical. I wish our government taxed us for our carbon, but we don't believe in that because it's not good for business. So ethical business people tax themselves until we get around to it. In 2020 and 2021, we took nobody to Europe. So I didn't have to do that investment, but I was so impressed and inspired by the work that the people we invested in the year before did with the money we gave them that we continued to support them. We invested $500,000 in 2020 and $500,000 in 2021 in these 10 organizations. They're amazing. If you want to learn more about our program and the philosophy about it and so on, go to ricksteves.com and look in the Climate Smart Initiative pages, and then you can go to the portfolio and see what these companies are doing. This year, we fully expect to take 25,000 people on our tours. We've got their money already. I mean, they've paid deposits on these tours. And we're going to invest $30 for each of those people and round it up to $1 million. And we will invest another $1 million in climate change. Please expect the people you buy travel from to be doing something to mitigate the problem they're creating by making people travel. We want to travel. We should travel. We shouldn't be flight shamed out of travel, but we should mitigate the carbon we create by investing in ways that we can do good that matches the bad we create when we fly. That's my little sermon about how travelers can travel and still be good stewards of this environment. Hey, a few years ago, it was the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. I didn't want to miss that. We made a one-hour TV documentary on public television about the Reformation and why it was so important. And three very important cities from that show are Erfurt, Wittenberg, and the castle Wartburg. Here's a little clip from our TV show about these places. I hope you enjoy it.
In 1517, the German monk Martin Luther was a professor here in the university town of Wittenberg. As professors routinely did back then, he tacked some points for discussion on the door of the church, which served as kind of a bulletin board for the university community. These 95 points, questioning practices of the Roman Catholic Church, kicked off more than a discussion, they kicked off the Protestant Reformation.
Martin Luther unleashed a world of change. The Reformation was a political and theological storm that divided Christendom in Western Europe into Roman Catholics and Protestants. It ignited a century of religious wars, and along with the humanism of the Renaissance, it helped bring Western civilization out of the Middle Ages and into the modern world.
2017 marked the 500th anniversary of the Protestant Reformation. And Eastern Germany is famous for its Lutherstadts, or Luther cities, and sites associated with that tumultuous time.
The three most interesting Reformation stops are Erfurt, where Luther studied and first became a monk, Wartburg, the castle where he famously hid out and translated the Bible into German, and Wittenberg, where he taught, preached, and led the Reformation. Luther went to law school here in Erfurt, and today this half-timbered medieval town, with a shallow river gurgling through its center, remains a charming destination that Luther himself would recognize. Erfurt's atmospheric Merchants Bridge is lined with shops and homes. Then, as now, merchants live upstairs above their shops. This is the land of fairy tales and the Brothers Grimm, fine wood carvers and fanciful puppets. You can peek into the workshop of Martin Gopsch. Observe him at work. And don't leave without popping a coin into his tiny theater. The evil queen welcomes you into the dreamy world of Snow White. Separate vignettes tell the story. It all leads to the happy ending when the charming prince whisks Snow White away. Back in 1505, as a young student, Martin Luther became a monk in Erfurt's Augustinian monastery. In this church, he gave his first mass. Its little museum includes Luther artifacts and the simple cell where the novice monk lived. Little did they know that this humble novice would change the course of European history.
Wow. Ha! I love Martin Luther. He's so cool. He's amazing. Now you may think, wow, I want to learn more about Martin Luther. How do I do that? Well, you can watch our 1 hour show on Luther and the Reformation. It's available at ricksteves.com anytime. And you can go to Germany and you can use this guidebook right here. There's a whole section on the Luther Road. All of the different places had to have something to do with Luther. It's fascinating history. And the guy really had an impact 500 years ago. Now we're going to go to the big city, Berlin, and we're going to pal around with my good friend Holger Zimmer. Holger is one of our guides. And when you meet Holger here, you'll understand why people just love our tours. We have such great guides. I'm so thankful for the work of our guides, and I'm so thankful that they can be back on the road now as we start our tour program again. But Holger, like any of our guides, helps me when I'm in town with the TV crew. And Holger took us on a walk around his neighborhood in Berlin. Prenzlauenberg is where I stay when I'm with a hotel in Berlin. And Holger did this wonderful bit with us, and people oftentimes want to see what landed on the cutting room floor. Well, this is a great bit that just, we didn't have time for it in the half hour show, and it landed tragically on the cutting room floor. But no, it lives. It lives on Monday Night Travel. So join us now in Berlin with Holger as he takes me around to enjoy his neighborhood and get a little tour guiding context as we do it.
To better understand this dynamic city, I'm joined by my fellow tour guide and local journalist, Holger Zimmer.
Well, this is Prenzlauer Berg. This is my neighborhood, really, you know. And I've been living here since the end of communism, and I've seen a lot of changes here. It's a fine example of how Berlin developed back in the 1850s, 70s, Industrial Revolution comes along. The population of Berlin doubled within the space of 30 years, from 1 to 2 million. So people need apartments, people need a space to live. So that's why all these buildings were...
Huge building project. Look at this. Lots of workers' accommodation.
And we were lucky that we can still see them because they haven't been destroyed in the Second World War much. So that's pretty much survived here. And then after 45, this is East Berlin here. This is communism. So people don't pay rent, so the buildings actually collapse.
So it got really run down during communism.
But that means when 89 comes along, the wall falls, people move in, young people, students, creative people move in here, and they basically take these old buildings that no one else wanted to live there anymore, with coal heating, with like a toilet that's just kind of like half a floor down, and they come and live there, you know, and they doll it up and they change the place completely.
Must have been very creative time.
Absolutely, lots of vibe, lots of people out on the rooftops playing guitar, playing music, just meeting on the street. And I mean, the artists, let's face it, they've gone. But
so
other people are here.
That's gentrification. It's cool. People come in with money.
Yes.
The creative people move out. And now you've got comfortable, desirable apartments.
Yeah. And like me, like I came here as a student. Mm-hmm. Now I have kids and I enjoy living here.
So you don't have to go downstairs
Absolutely.
For the toilet.
Absolutely. Yes. And I don't need to bring up my bucket of coal anymore.
Nice.
So here's a place where the old spirit still survives.
Let's take a peek in.
So this was originally squatters.
This was a squatter place, yes.
And today?
The next
today they're paying rent?
Today they're paying rent. And they still like care for their house and they still do something. Of course, like they don't have much money, but they still keep it up.
We're whispering because they don't like TV crews coming into their courtyard, but I had to come in here and show this to you. This is such a cool dimension of Berlin. Remember, they've got these courtyards that go deeper and deeper and deeper in these giant apartment blocks off the street that oftentimes we travelers are oblivious to.
The former squatters now have a place to stay.
I love these happy little crossing signals. They're so jaunty.
Yeah, that's one thing people here really kept from the communist times, and they really fought for them.
It's a popular demand.
Yeah, and we call them Ampelmännchen.
Ampelmännchen.
Little light men.
Okay, Ampelmännchen.
Kastanienallee is sort of like the spine of Prenzlauer Berg. What's the character of Kastanienallee?
So Kastanienallee also was just one of many streets, but it kind of got famous because lots of, you know, clubs and bars, you know, were settling there in the early 90s, and now they name it Casting Alley for, like, you know, all the hip, young, trendy or wannabe trendy people kind of be seen walking here and strutting the catwalk, and that's kind of what it is to this day. Some people actually don't like it anymore. I still find it still kind of colorful and happy.
It's so nice to walk through town with somebody who lives there, who's a tour guide and knows how to make it just come to life. And that was Holger Zimmer in Berlin. And we were talking about Prenzlauer Berg, former Eastern Berlin. Now the trendiest place to go if you are looking for a hotel. That's where I call home when I'm in Berlin. All right. Hey, I want to show you a few more slides. I love when I go to Germany to go to Rothenburg. It's a touristy place. But remember, in its day, it was a very important city. It was a bigger city than Frankfurt, and it had a lot of money. It was on the trade route. What we call the Romantic Road today, it was romantic today because it was rich in the old days, in the Middle Ages, long before Germany was united. It's a walled town with a beautiful wall and a rampart that you can actually hike around. I love to hike around the town via its rampart. And it's you can kind of get a sense of how a medieval town would have had gathered together behind the wall for security. Yeah, the corners are just higgly-piggly. This is a little corner called Plumb Line because they couldn't use a plumb line to make any straight lines there. And nearby is the Crime and Punishment Museum. There's a lot of tacky torture dungeons and so on in Europe. If you want to get serious about medieval crime and punishment, you got to go to this museum in Rothenburg. It's amazing. And don't miss an hour or so with the night watchman. He is just the coolest guy. His name is George, and I've been visiting him for 20 years, and he just has found his niche. Every night he gives a walk in German and a walk later on in English, and he is just a lot of fun. And he plays the role of the night watchman 800 years ago, and you learn a lot about what Rothenburg was like way back then. Now, the Romantic Road leads from Munich, basically, or the road over the Alps, south of Munich, all the way to Wiesbaden, and there it connects with the Romantic Rhine. And when we think about the Rhine River, remember the Rhine goes from Switzerland all the way to Amsterdam, but when tourists think of the Rhine, they just think of a, like a 30-mile stretch near Frankfurt. between Frankfurt and Koblenz. And this is the romantic Rhine gorge. It's buried at the bottom of this gorge, and you got all of these castles, and these were robber baron castles when there were 300 independent countries in what is today Germany. And these were little petty dukedoms and fiefdoms and kingdoms, and they could all levy tolls when people came by. Their castles were built on the river or even in the river, like this one. This is Falk's castle, and they'd put their chains out when the boat came. They'd draw the chain up, the boat would have to pay, or they'd go into the little debtor's prison. And then when they paid their debt, they could drop the chain and the boat could carry on. And remember, in the Middle Ages, any merchant that wanted to get his goods to town would prefer to do it by boat, because that was safer and more economic than taking it overland. The Rhine today is lined by charming towns, plenty of boat tours, plenty of ruined castles to hike up to, and just a lot of fun to check out. Bacharach is one of my favorite towns to stay in. Our group stay right here in Bacharach. It's a half-timber delight, and this is one of our tour groups. And we've had a busy day exploring the castles on the Rhine, and now we're gathering in the little patio of our hotel. And it's right on the train line. So it's got triple pane windows. This is a big deal. This is the earliest train line in Germany. It went right up and down the Rhine River. And it's all part of the scene you enjoy when you're there enjoying your white wine. Now, the very, very emotional dear and near to the German soul corner of the country is the Deutsche Ecke, the German corner. And this is where the Mosel and the Rhine rivers come together. Big monument there to Kaiser Wilhelm. And the Rhine River is what we all know and dream about seeing. But I'll tell you, the Mosel River, the little river that is the baby sister of the Rhine, this is probably your image of the Rhine River. It's sleepier. It's more meandering. There's no train or highways there. It's lined with little half-timbered villages, corduroy hills, blanketed in vineyards and ruined castles you can hike up to for a nice view. It's just a beautiful part of Germany, and that's the Mosel, M-O-S-E-L River. On the Mosel, there's the biggest town, I think, in the touristic area is Kokum. And Kokum is capped by a romantic castle, but nearby is my favorite castle. This is Burg Eltz, E-L-T-Z. I'm spelling it because I want you to remember it. It's my favorite castle in Germany, and partly because it is in kind of a haunted romantic forest. You hike through the forest to get there, and then you've come there, and the Eltz family still owns it. The lady of the manor puts flowers in each room every week. You can go inside and see the interior of the castle, quite beautifully preserved, with an English language tour. Okay, so now we go to the Black Forest. And the Black Forest is the natural holiday escape country. This is where overworked Germans go for a little R&R. And it is the thick forest, therefore the Black Forest, right on the border of France. The border of France and Germany is the Rhine River, and the border of the Black Forest is the Rhine River. The biggest stop on the Black Forest for me, you can see the town surrounded by the forest, is Baden-Baden. Baden-Baden, if I understand correctly, means bath-bath or spa-spa. Baden is the name for a spa town, and I don't know why, but this one's called Baden-Baden. That's where you go for your beautiful spas, your casinos, your chance to luxuriate in the venerable baths. It's just quite a culture. And you can do that when you're in the Black Forest. Don't miss that. And then when you go to Germany and the Black Forest, you'll want to check out the open-air folk museums. These open-air folk museums, you find them all over Northern Europe. They're famous in Scandinavia. Every capital in Scandinavia has its own open-air folk museum. It's Kultur on a Lazy Susan, where you got historic buildings gathered from every corner of the country and reassembled right there in a park in the city. So you don't have to travel all the way up to Lapland to see a Lapland community. You can go into the park. Well, in Germany, you've got historic buildings from all over that corner of Germany gathered together here in the park. In the Black Forest, the open air folk museum. Wonderful look, wonderful time tunnel experience, a wonderful chance to see German culture. And of course, this is the land of cuckoo clocks. So there's actually a museum there about cuckoo clocks. We're gonna go to Mad Ludwig's castle in just a bit. But right now, I want to remind you that we could not do Monday Night Travel without our beautiful and wonderful and hardworking and talented staff. We got Lisa Friend right now moderating. We've got Julianne Worden in the back room organizing all of your questions. And we've got Gabe that is taking a week off. He'll be with us next week. And we've got Ben Green. He took a year off to study in Russia. And Ben was in St. Petersburg when all the trouble broke out in Ukraine. And thank God Ben is out of Russia now, along with all the other American students. We just talked to him the other day, and everybody evacuated Russia, and now they're continuing their education in Helsinki. It's just so many just heartbreaking little ripple effects of one man's megalomania. Oh my goodness. But life goes on for most of us. Hey, I do want to remind you, in a few minutes, we will be having Q&A. And if you see the Q&A widget there, ask Julianne a question. She'll organize that and then give it to Lisa, and Lisa will ask me when we're done with our videos. Also remind you that if you look at the chat section, that's where we've got links to everything we're talking about today. All the shows you might be interested in from things I'm talking about. I've got a whole hour-long talk just on Germany that I think would be really, really of practical value if you're dreaming about a trip there and so on. So take full advantage of the links and also ask a question, and you and I will connect that way. All right. Hey, hope you're enjoying your drink. It's good. I'm going to be in Germany in a couple of weeks. Having a great beer, but in a German surrounding, which always helps to me. In a week, I fly to, where am I going? I'm going to London with the crew. I got 12 days to shoot with the crew because we're finishing up our art series that I've been talking about for so long. It's coming along really good. I've got a 6-hour mini series. We've never done this before. It's going to air nationally, public television. So really excited about it, from prehistory to the present. And we're going to spend 4 or 5 days in London and out in the countryside, Stonehenge and everything. Then we're going to go to Paris and go out to the countryside of France for some Gothic cathedrals and some medieval towns, but mostly Paris. And then I say goodbye to the TV crew. They fly home with all the footage. I meet my buddy Steve Smith, and we're going to work on the France guidebook together. And then I'm going to spend the next 30 days in 8 or 10 cities, 3 days in each city. I'm going to fly to Vienna. So I'm going to go to Athens. Then I'm going to Milano, Florence, Venice, Munich, Salzburg, Vienna, and then fly to Brussels, Bruges, and Amsterdam before I come home. So I'm excited to get back to Europe. Cameron, my right-hand man, one of our most prolific guidebook writers, he's been over there for a couple of weeks. He just finished updating London, and he reports that that travel is good as ever. It's very smooth. He reports that there is remarkably little damage caused by the pandemic when it comes to all the listings in our hotel, in our guidebooks, all the little mom and pop bed and breakfast hotels, bistros, cafes, and so on. They're still in business. I'm very thankful for that. Okay, let's see. I'm going to take you now to Nuremberg. Nuremberg is the most German of German cities. If Hitler was going to have a favorite place to have his rallies, it would be Nuremberg. Let me show you why. Nuremberg, about an hour away from Munich in Bavaria.
Nuremberg, so steeped in German history, was nicknamed the most German of German cities. That's one reason it was a favorite of Hitler's. A short tram ride from the center is a collection of important Nazi sites. When Hitler took power in 1933, he made Nuremberg's Zeppelin Field the site of his enormous Nazi party rallies. The stark remains of this massive gathering place are thought-provoking. For several years, increasingly elaborate celebrations of Nazi culture, ideology, and power took place right here.
Imagine Hitler stepping out of that door, overlooking the masses, 200,000 people being lined up. He used propaganda to create a new community. In fact, we even have a word for it. It's called Volksgemeinschaft.
The chilling images from Leni Riefenstahl's documentary Triumph of the Will were filmed at the 1934 Nuremberg rallies and then shown in every theater and schoolroom in the country.
I'm sorry, I just got a break in here. Considering what's happening in our world, at home and abroad, if you have not watched my 1-hour special on lessons learned from fascism in Europe in the 20th century, as soon as we're done tonight, please go to ricksteves.com, go into the TV section, click on the special about lessons from fascism. It is so poignant. It speaks to us right now. It's mind-blowing. If you haven't watched it, please check it out.
The goal? To bring a visual celebration of the power of the Nazi state to every person in Germany. Looming over a now peaceful lake is another remnant of the dictator's megalomania, his huge yet unfinished Nazi Congress Hall. Hitler was enamored with the Roman Colosseum. He had his Congress Hall modeled on that, but built much bigger.
Imagine 50,000 leading Nazis in here, one third higher, covered by a roof, a window inside the ceiling, sunshine would have fallen down to the podium, once a year, one speech of Adolf Hitler. Adolf Hitler liked huge buildings. He was a big fan of the architectural style named neoclassicism. And the idea was to make the individual feel small.
This really makes me feel small here.
Yeah, it's so that you give away the responsibility of your life and you get something back in return. That is a bright new future.
The Nazi Documentation Center fills one wing of the hall. This superb museum does its best to answer the question, how could Germany's Nazi nightmare have happened? It traces the evolution of the Nazi movement, focusing on how it somehow both energized and terrified the German people.
This is not a World War II or Holocaust museum. In fact, those events are barely mentioned. Instead, the center frankly analyzes the origin and evolution of the Nazi phenomenon to help better understand it and help prevent it from ever happening again.
Exhibits offer insights into the creation of the messiah/pop star image of Hitler, the mass hypnosis of the German nation. You'll see his manifesto, Mein Kampf, mementos that placed the dictator alongside Bismarck and Beethoven in the pantheon of German greats, and souvenirs from his rallies. With postcards like these, the Hitler mania generated by these rallies was shared across the land. Of course, Hitler's promises were trumped up and led not to glory, but to war, the Holocaust, and the devastation of Germany. The challenges of building and maintaining a peaceful future are ongoing.
Incorporated into this museum's are classrooms like this.
Why is that?
Because every student, military, policeman should learn from our difficult history.
So this really is today part of German education?
Yeah, it finally arrived in our education system.
Imagine that their police and their military learned not to follow the orders of somebody who is going to do the crimes of a man like Hitler or Putin. Okay, now we're going to go to Berlin. And I was just thinking with my staff about our Berlin tour. We're planning a new 1 week Berlin tour. And we want to make a great itinerary. And I said, we really need to spend 1 day outside of Berlin out of those the entire week. And we talked about it and we decided the best single day out of Berlin is Potsdam. Potsdam is pretty close by. It's got great palaces, great parks, great lakes. And it's got a lot of World War II history and a lot of communist history. There's a secret prison there that was run by the KGB when Vladimir Putin was in Germany working as a big shot in the KGB. It's a fascinating and horrifying place. You've got the Bridge of Spies where the West and the communists, the Soviets would trade spies. And under that, you've got a beautiful lake, which is a party lake. Join me now with a friend of mine, Lee Evans, who is a guide in Berlin on the Bridge of Spies.
Hey, I'm Rick Steves, just outside of Berlin with my guide, Lee Evans.
Hi.
Hey, Lee. And Lee, this is the Wahnsinn. What are these guys doing?
These guys are renting a raft. It's really cheap. It comes with a keg of beer. And they're just driving around the Wahnsinn.
All right.
For as long as they feel like it. The Germans at work and play right here.
Germans know how to live well. And they've got a lot of history, too. What happened on this bridge? What's this bridge?
This is the Bridge of Spies. So we're standing on the East German side of it. This is where three spy exchanges took place in the Cold War.
This is it. So that would be the East, and this would be the West. And if you got a spy that you want to change over,
you meet him right here, and you say, viel Glück.
Okay, let's go from the East of Potsdam over the spy bridge.
Into Berlin.
Into Berlin.
just like Gary Powers and Anatoly Sharansky.
Okay, we're going to go back into Berlin now. It's just a short drive away, and we're going to go to the Reichstag building. I showed you that earlier, the Congress building, the Capitol building, the Parliament building, which was bombed out, and then they built that glass dome on the top. We're halfway up the glass dome. You can walk on that ramp all the way to the tippy top and look down, like the Germans do, through the glass window and see their parliamentarians, their representatives working. They can keep an eye on them symbolically by this design of this structure. We're going to walk all the way around that dome, 360 degrees. And I just want to narrate for you what you'll see as you make that walk around the Parliament building when you look out at the great city of Berlin.
Hi, I'm Rick Steves. I'm halfway up the glass dome of the Reichstag building, the Parliament building in Berlin, the capital of Germany. And a lot of great sightseeing from up here. There's the Spree River that cuts Berlin in half. And there's the television tower built back in communist times. I'm just going to walk around, give you like a 360-degree view of the city. You got your European Union flag, as you do, and Parliament buildings all over Europe. You got Potsdamer Platz. That was once the busiest square in Europe. Then it was a no-man's land in the Berlin Wall. And then now it's the big business park. You got the German flag flapping proudly in the wind. Up on the roof of this building, you had the last days of World War II fun. Russians and Nazis were up here fighting it out on the very last days of the war before Germany capitulated. Here we have the huge park of Berlin with the Siegessäule, the beautiful tower in the middle. And then next to that is the Chancellery, that big giant-sized building. Is the home, sort of the White House of Germany. And moving along, we pass the Hauptbahnhof, the most impressive train station in all of Europe. This is all government buildings in downtown Berlin. And we can see the city is just being built. There's cranes everywhere. And now we come back to where we started. This is the Spree River. They used to shoot people when they tried to swim across there in the old days. And now the city is facing the river. Cruise boats and everything, people celebrating the good life in Berlin. And there we are, 360 degrees, a look at the exciting city of Berlin. And when Germans come up here, what they want to look is down through that window onto the desks of their legislators to keep an eye on what's going on. This is the powerful force of democracy in Germany at the Reichstag building with their new beautiful glass dome. I'm Rick Steves. And I want to wish you happy travels.
Boy, I don't know about you, but that was interesting. Now, if you're going to Berlin and you want to get into that building and you want to find out when it's open, how do I get a ticket? What does everything mean? How can I have somebody tell me what I'm looking at as I go around on that walk? Where would you find that information? Where would you find that information? Well, this is about 1,050 pages of information. I would bet everything I said is in here, plus a lot more. The point is, man, oh man, I love finding out about these great places, taking local tours and guides, learning about all the ins and outs and how to get tickets, and how to avoid the crowds and how to bring it to meaning. This is in here. That's why these guidebooks are the best-selling guidebooks in the United States. That's why I'm going to Europe next week, and I'm going to update these books with all of my colleagues here at Rick Steves Europe. Remember, you've got the information to turn your travel dreams into smooth and affordable reality if you equip yourself with good information and expect yourself to travel smart. All right. Hey, let's go right now back to my little PowerPoint as I want to continue with my quick tour of Germany. And once again, I want to remind you, I've got a much fuller, more relaxed and well-designed hour and a half or so of a lecture on Germany with photographs like this on our website in the University of Rick Steves Corner, where we have all of our talks. It's free and it's designed for you to learn from our experience rather than your own so you can have a better trip. When you go to Southern Germany, you're gonna wanna see Mad King Ludwig's castle. He probably would prefer to be called King Ludwig II of Bavaria, but us tourists call him Mad King Ludwig because he spent so much money on his crazy castles. It's important to remember this was built during the same generation as the Eiffel Tower. This is Romanticism. This is a neo-medieval done in the late 1800s. And we can hike up to that castle with my groups. I love to get to know Ludwig And then this is one of our tour groups, and we hike up a little higher above it so we get a beautiful romantic view of it. And then we tour this thing, and it is just wallpapered with romantic art. It's quite an amazing experience to see all of this and the view that that king had. With our tours, we stay over the border just on the far side of that lake, about an hour's hike in Austria. And here's an example of how active a Rick Steves tour is. In the morning, those who want to hike can hike with the guide across the border, crossing the border in the middle of the forest as they walk over the hills, and they walk along the lake and get to the castle on their own. Those who want another hour of sleep instead, well, they catch the bus that our bus driver then takes them all the way to the castle. We rendezvous there, so people who want to take the hike can do that, people who want to take it easy can do that, and we all see the castle together. What we do after that is cross back into Austria, and we go to my favorite ruined castle. It's a wonderful sort of way to complement the fairy tale castle, is to see an honest to goodness castle that's about 1,000 years older. And we hike up there. And before we visit the castle, we cross that scary bridge and we get a group shot. And then we go back across the scary bridge and we have some fun, just frolicking with the sword ferns and have a little bit of our fantasy time in a medieval castle. Another fun experience is to take the summer Rodelbahn. That's the luge, the mountain luge in Europe. They get more mileage out of their ski lifts by having these racetracks where you take the ski lift up, then you sit on this go-kart and you push that stick forward and the pads come off the wheels and you go screaming down the mountain. Munich was the capital of Bavaria, a major power in Europe until the big movement to unite Germany around 1870. But Munich was the capital of Bavaria, ruled for 600 years by the Wittelsbach family. And when I look at a map, I want to see history in that map. What's that circle doing there? Did they plan that circle, or was that a wall from the Middle Ages when they needed a wall around the town? And then it got bigger and they had a central government, they didn't need to protect their town with a wall and they had congested traffic. What do? You tear down the wall and you got a circular system of roads, or you got a circle of parks and the moat becomes lakes. And this is what you got in cities like Munich. You'll see that all, oh, you see it in Paris, you see it in London, you see it in Rome, you see it in Vienna, circular roads that are the shadow of medieval walls. Marienplatz is the middle of that zone. By the way, when you see that circle is what's important for your sightseeing. That's the historic center of the town. If you look to the far left, outside of that circle, you see the train station. It's about a 20-minute walk from the train station to the main square, Marienplatz. And the main square, this is the main square here, was bombed flat in 1945 and rebuilt since. When we look at the old fortifications of Munich, it seems like it was just built about 50 years ago. On the cheap. Well, it's true. It was bombed out in the war. They didn't have a lot of money in the 50s, but they wanted to rebuild it. So it's got about as much historic authenticity as a wall at Disneyland. But it gives some sense of where the wall was. And here you see the pedestrian zone. It used to be a busy traffic street, but now it's a ped zone taking you right downtown. Beautiful palace of the Wittelsbach family when you go into the center of Munich, the residence. And also you've got the Victulian market, a typical Bavarian market where you've got the breweries hosting their wonderful picnic zone under the chestnut trees, beautiful beer, great place to enjoy the traditional food, great cheese, great bread, great olives, great sauerkraut, and great parks to enjoy it with your travel partner. In the big park in Munich, and Europeans have wonderful parks, don't miss them. Munich has its own surfing section. In the river, they've got a perpetual wave and people line up to do their daredevil work right there in the park. It's pretty fun to watch. And I suppose if you're a surfer, it's pretty fun to do it. More people enjoy having a beer hall lunch in the garden. And here you can see the big beers. Those beers are 1 liter. That's like a quart. That's in England. They're called ein Maß in German. We call it ein Pitcher in English. But this is the standard beer. If you ask for a beer, this is what you're going to get. Mm. And if you want to have Oktoberfest any time of the year, you go to the Hofbrauhaus or one of countless big breweries, beer halls in Munich. Not countless. I think there's 8 or 10 of them. And they are just wonderful. You go in there and you got your live music. You got your Germans with their lederhosen, and you've got a chance to have a lot of fun. This is the gate of Oktoberfest. And this was a tour that I was leading around. It was our Best of Europe tour that I was leading a few years ago. And we came into Munich, as we do on every one of our Best of Europe tours. But this was special because Oktoberfest was going on. There's 2 weeks, starting in the third Saturday of September. Yeah, that has Oktoberfest. And if we're there during Oktoberfest, you can bet your guide on a Rick Steves bus is going to find a way to get the group into Oktoberfest. It's easy. You just park the bus and you all stay together and you walk through and you orient and disperse and have a great time. When you go to Oktoberfest, you see these tents, and there's, I forget exactly, 8 tents or something like that. Each is jam packed, and there's a little bit of skill in enjoying it. The clientele and the atmosphere changes as the night gets later. For most of our readers, you'll have a more enjoyable time probably earlier rather than later when it gets really crowded and ruckus, but you choose when you want to go. Remember, there's good security in events like this now all over Europe, and you will have people checking at the gate, making sure that everybody who goes in is safe, and the German police make sure it's safe inside also. I noticed at the main intersections, you've got the police in a circle, constantly looking in every direction at all times to keep an eye on what's going on. And our responsibility is to enjoy the beer and the ambience in that greatest party in all of Europe. So that is our look at Germany. This is our route, by the way, of our Best of Germany tour. It's, I believe, 13 days, and it's just an exciting trip around Germany. I just checked on our website, and we have about 15 departures this year, and all of them are sold out. I was going to say unfortunately, but no, I'm thankful they're sold out. We have wait lists for all those dates. And, you know, we're taking good care of our wait list, and we may open up a couple more departures if we have people on the wait list that would like to go. But there is also another tour that's 14 days called the Best of Germany, Austria, and Switzerland that does have some seats available. So you might want to check that out if you would like to get some German traveling in with us this coming season. All right. Now I want to finish off with just a 3-minute concert for you. One of the great joys for me in my TV production was to share my love of music, my love of Europe, my love of history, all together with my local symphony here in Edmonds, the Cascade Symphony Orchestra. So we made a concert called The Symphonic Journey, made a TV show out of it. We've got a beautiful package here that has a little booklet in there that tells the whole historic background of this. But this aired all over the United States. You can see it on our website at ricksteves.com if you want to watch the concert. But I was just in Minnesota 2 weeks ago hosting it. I was on the stage celebrating the same thing. I stood on the stage, and I'm going to set up the Germany section here. But we went to 7 different countries. I've had the joy of going all around the country with Boston Pops. I did the Houston Symphony Orchestra. I was just a Seattle Symphony a couple of weeks before COVID hit. And I'm just thrilled to be able to share that. And here I would like to just invite you to enjoy the rest of your beer, enjoy your radishes, enjoy your travel dreams. And what the delight of this is I get to set it up like a good tour guide would. And then we have edited together beautiful images. So you can watch the images while you listen to the music and better understand the genius of the composer and what was going on in Europe in the late 1800s. The entire concert was from the same generation, the late 1800s. Here we go with a little bit of Richard Wagner.
Tonight's program is a symphonic journey, touching down in 7 different countries. And with the help of video and music, we'll gain an appreciation for how 19th century Europe helped shape the beautiful world that we live in today. The theme of the concert is romanticism and nationalism. Nearly all the music we'll hear today is from about the same generation, from the late 1800s, from the Romantic Age. And this music championed national causes, and it also supported this exciting notion of common people finally taking the reins in their society. From Norway to Italy, from England to the Czech Republic. For this piece, we sail up the Danube into Germany. You know, 150 years ago, Germany wasn't there. It was a bunch of little German-speaking states with a dream for German nationalism, for German unity. And remember, in the 19th century, all over Europe, national groups like this were coalescing, and romantic music supported them. In 1871, that grab bag of little German-speaking fiefdoms and dukedoms finally became the Germany we know today. And at that time, the romantic composer Richard Wagner was in his prime. Wagner was a political radical. He was a nonconformist, an individual's individual, kind of the quintessential romantic. And he's a reminder that romanticism was about more than rising nations. It was also championing personal freedoms and individualism. This next piece is from an opera by Wagner, Die Meistersinger. It's the story of a common man overcoming the tyranny of tradition to win his lady love. Up now, Wagner's overture to Die Meistersinger.
Oh, baby, that was good. I don't want to get into the bloopers yet. All right. Hey, Lisa, I hope you enjoyed that. And I think we are ready for some questions.
Enjoyed it? That timpani player in the symphony was so dreamy.
Hey, tell us who that was.
That was my husband, Scott Friend. He's actually down the street playing right now. The symphony's playing.
Is that right? Oh, fantastic. Yes. I love our community orchestra. And this is the way we celebrated volunteer orchestras all over the United States. That's great.
Arts are important. Before we get to our questions, could we have a word from our sponsor, please?
Thank you, Lisa. And the word from our sponsor today is the fact that, well, at Rick Steves Europe, we're a band of 100 travel enthusiasts, you, me, and 98 others. And we've been sort of in lockdown for 2 years. We've been keeping busy, that's for sure. Right now we are kind of excited. There's sort of an exuberance, isn't there, Lisa, as we start to travel again. And we've got our tours going. We've got our researchers going. We're making our guidebooks new and up to date. We've got 8 or 10 of our tours have finished successfully now, and we are ready to start to ramp up. And I'm heading off to Europe in a week. So we've got a lot going on. If you're dreaming about going to Europe, if you're comfortable going this year, it's you know, admittedly, it's kind of a crazy time. We're still coming out of COVID. We've got all of this tragedy unfolding in Ukraine, but life goes on and we're committed to the value of travel. Our mission is to equip and inspire people from the United States to venture beyond Orlando, to get comfortable and friendly with the rest of the world and come home with what we think is the most beautiful souvenir. And that is a greater appreciation for how blessed we are to live right here and of the importance of taking care of our democracy. And at the same time, empathy for the other 96% of humanity, and in a mindset where we're more inclined to build bridges and less inclined to build walls. And if that's all that we create, is that heightened awareness of the beauty of this world and the importance of exploring it, we are very thankful for the work that we have. So that's our philosophy at Rick Steves Europe. And right now we're going forward. So let's have some questions.
I'm so proud to work here and I'm so happy that you said that. I'm gonna start with a super easy question because I'm all choked up right now. Katie would like to know, are there overrated tourist traps in Germany that she should avoid?
Yes, there's overrated tourist traps all over Europe. I hate to rag on certain cities. I rave about
going negative
without going negative on other places, but I don't know why anybody would go to Wiesbaden on the Rhine. It's just the over the top big bus tour depot. You know, I don't really understand why everybody goes to Heidelberg. I mean, it was a big deal 100 years ago in Romantic Age travel, but not that Heidelberg and Wiesbaden are bad places. It's just there's so much other stuff to see and do. There are a lot of touristy places in Bavaria that all the tour groups go to, and they're ready there with their lederhosen and their dirndls and their yodeling and so on. But the places that we talk about are the places that we think are legit and really worthwhile. I would just be selective. We Americans have the shortest vacations in the rich world, and you just want to be select on where you're going to go and the places we recommend in our guidebooks and on our tours and the places that we visit with our TV shows. They're the ones that we think are worth your time.
Thank you. On a positive note, Allison would say, she would ask you, if you had to choose only one meal to enjoy in Germany, what would you eat and drink?
I would go to a little town, House Lippmann. It's a little town, Beilstein, on the Mosel. Do you know this place?
Yes.
And a wonderful family runs the place, and they've got a trellis over the patio, which is overlooking the Mosel, and you're surrounded by vineyards and ruined castles and a meandering river. And I would just have a good, solid local meal right there at House Lippmann in Beilstein on the Mosel River. Oh, God, I love that. That's where I go to convalesce. If I'm burned out, if I need just to be, if I want to shuffle around in slippers all day long and eat well that evening, I go to Beilstein.
Beilstein, you cannot overestimate how charming that town is.
Yeah.
Okay. Susan would like to know, and I'm paraphrasing, what is the German attitude towards World War II and the Holocaust now?
It's an interesting question, Susan, because in my younger days, I went to Germany and nobody talked about World War II. People didn't know about Hitler. It was just, you don't go there. And I think, you know, I think the reality is Uncle Knut was still alive and Grandpa Heinz was still, you know, coming to visit on Sunday. And these guys were the bad guys in World War II. And you just didn't want to go there because it would just be a horrible thing for the family. Well, now Grandpa Heinz and Uncle Knut are gone and people can look at World War II with more candor and more honesty. And Germany has done, an admirable job of dealing with their dark past. Germany, this is one of my themes in my lecturing, Germany understands the consequences of a dumbed down electorate. A lot of political societies would rather not have critical thinking electorate so they can dupe their electorate. I see that in the United States, frankly. You know, there's a lot of people that think it's dangerous to create a bunch of critical thinkers. Everybody should just be good producer consumers, you know, be an engineer, be a whatever skill you got with the science and math and so that you can make a society that is materially wealthy. Well, that's important. But if we're not poets, if we're not historians, if we're not critical thinkers, if we're not interested in art, what have we accomplished? And critical thinkers weave the fabric of a democracy much stronger than a bunch of people who just know how to do their job right. Germany learned that. And today Germany celebrates the value of a liberal education. Germany funds education. And in the old days, high school teachers conveniently ran out of time before they got to the Third Reich. It was like a little
you just don't talk about this little joke on history that we never talk about it because we run out of time. Now they start the year with the rise of Hitler in 11th grade or something like that. And you spend the year learning about Hitler, the rise of fascism and the Holocaust. Every student in Germany has to go to a concentration camp. Germany is owning up to its past. More importantly, Germany is learning from its past. I'm a historian. I've got a degree in history. I'm certainly no fancy scholar, but I've got a respect for history. And that's one reason I'm just so thankful I've got a little niche where I can share my passion for history, not because history is necessarily interesting. I find it very interesting, because it's important. I got a business degree. I got a history degree. And then all my loved ones said, you should get a business degree or some kind of degree that has a practical value. Looking back 40 years later, my history degree has been every bit as practical value as my business degree. I'm so thankful for it. And anybody that talks a young person out of a degree in liberal arts to get something practical is insulting that person, because that person can change the world more likely than not with a liberal arts degree.
Well said. Let's see. A different Susan asks, if you could go back in time, which German city would you like to live in?
Ha. Huh. If I could go back in time. I'd like to live in Vienna. It's not technically German, it's Austrian, but it's German speaking. I'd live in Vienna because that was such a cultural center under the Habsburgs, with all the great musicians there and with all the scientists there and all the literary characters there. That would have been really a cultural center with a great past. I mean, it has 1,000 years of history there as the home of the Holy Roman Emperor and so on. I'd go to Vienna.
That's a great answer. Let's see, Kevin wants to know, how hard is it to get into a tent at Oktoberfest without a reservation?
I've never had a reservation and I've always gotten into a tent. Late at night, it gets tougher to get into the tents. And frankly, I don't wanna be there when I'm at a bigger disadvantage because I don't speak German and I'm not looking to get rowdy. I think the character of the tent changes all day long. In the afternoon, it's a family environment. There's plenty of empty seats and it's easy to go there and have a civilized meal. And then later on, it gets sloppier and sloppier and noisier and noisier. So you just wanna know how much do you wanna turn the volume up? But as it gets later, it gets more crowded. So for most of my travelers, you'd have more fun there between 5 and 8 o'clock. It's plenty of fun for most people. And if you wanna put on shoulder pads and just dive right into the mosh pit, then go at 10 or 11 o'clock. But there's a lot of tents. Some tents are more trendy. Every tent has its own personality. Talk to locals and find out what is the personality. Some, you know, it's just, some are young and cool. Some are the local sort of biker crowd or cowboys or country western. It's funny. Each one has its own atmosphere and personality, and you want to learn that. I should say, Lisa, there's also the kind of the dorky tents or the tents that people don't want to go to, that for a tourist, they're just as much fun. And you'll always find a spot there. So don't be trying to pack into the most popular tent when you've got perfectly good tents just across the way.
Speaking of dorky, Robert wants to know which worst is best.
Which worst is best? My favorite worst is the Nürnberger sausage. It's famously as big as your little finger, and they come with 3 and a little bun and nice mustard. And every time I go to Nürnberg, the first thing I want is a Nürnberger sausage. When I go to Hofbrauhaus and the beer halls in Munich, I go for the Weisswurst with the sauerkraut. Weisswurst with sauerkraut. It's a good, simple, basic meal.
Okay. And Scott says, tonight's show will not be gluten-free.
Gluten-free.
Oh, not gluten-free. Speaking of things I'm thankful for, I had a friend who sent me this. I just want to show you what we found. Are you seeing that?
Oh my goodness. Hey, that is my Oompa days. Lisa, wow. So I was in the high school German band. There's my German professor, Harry Reinert.
And when I quit German, he took me out in the hall and he said, Steves, you will regret this. And this is well before I was doing any of my work. You know, I was just going to be a piano teacher all my life. I quit German and he's looking at me. He looks like out of a cartoon book for a German professor. And he was a great professor and he loved German culture and he ran the German Oompa band. And I was there with my buddies and I didn't have a German lederhosen. So I put on my Norwegian sweater, but I'm playing the sousaphone with my Rod Stewart hairdo and my felt hat that my dad and I had a competition of getting all the little pins on. Yeah. Ooh, hey, let me grab my, I'm going to grab my hat. Hang on, Lisa, just a sec. I want to show you my hat because my hoot hair hat by Ecken.
Oh,
there you go. This is the hat I'm wearing in that shot.
Seriously, from 1972?
Yeah, that's when on my very first trip to Germany in 69 with my dad and my mom, I bought this hat and my dad and I had a competition to fill it with these fun little pins from wherever you go.
That is fantastic.
That's an old hat. That was good souvenir time. There you go.
Speaking of souvenirs, let's ask one more question. Christina wanted to know, is there an etiquette at festivals? She heard a story from a friend that she had to pay more for her drink at this Christmas market and she didn't understand. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Well, you pay more at a festival for your drink than you would during non-festival time in certain cases, but that's just going to be clearly posted. I've never been to a place in Germany where they didn't have the prices posted. As a tourist, always know what you're supposed to pay. As I don't care how rich you are, as a matter of principle, you should insist on not being charged more because you're a tourist. So find the list and see what it is. But I've never heard that that's a real problem. I just think it's a people's thing. I mean, people are just slamming through there. One thing that's confusing at a beer hall is you pay a token for your mug and you pay, you know, an extra dollar for your mug. And you got to bring the mug back and something about the token. And then
a deposit?
Yeah, it's a deposit. And then you give them the token when you give them back your mug and then you get your dollar back, your euro. So that's something that causes some tourists some confusion. But beer is a great value when you're traveling. I mean, it's $10. You know, you'd pay $8 for a beer like this in Seattle, but you're talking triple this in a beer hall and it costs $10 and it's a great beer. You get music, you get all that craziness and you get a lifelong memory. What's not to like about that? And most people, one beer is gonna be absolutely plenty. So, hey, I have just really enjoyed reliving the joy I find in traveling in Germany. I hope you've enjoyed traveling with us. I wanna remind you, next week is my last week for 6 weeks because I'm going to Europe. I'm gonna be joined by our good friend, Stephen McPhillamy in Ireland. We're going to learn what Stephen's been up to, and we're going to celebrate Ireland with a great expert on Irish culture. After that, the Monday Night Travel crew, Lisa and Julianne and Gabe, are going to be hosting, and we've got Roberto from Tuscany. He's going to be here, and Christina Duarte from Portugal, and lots of great European guides and great destinations with our wonderful Monday Night Travel staff. So happy travels. Thank you so much for joining us, and we'll see you next week. I'm going to close with some bloopers. Because if you're not laughing at yourself and making a few mistakes, you're taking things too seriously. Let's go to Germany now and make a few mistakes.
The city realized that what had become a derelict industrial wasteland was actually prime real estate. These 95 points questioning the practices of the Roman Catholic Church kicked off more than a conversation. They kicked off the Protestant Reformation. On the one hand, the church worked to restore and reform, restore. And on the other hand, the church resorted to propaganda, intimidation, and outright force. It's a city that mixes a dynamic history with a delightful to stroll cityscape. In the 18th century, the larger-than-life Augustus the Strong kicked off Saxony's golden age. Yeah!
Yeah, you want to rock.
Every student, law enforcement, and police should learn from our difficult history.
Military too.
This is an example of how I kind of rough up my local friends and tour guides, because there's sometimes I want them to mention it. All the students, all the policemen, and the military too. And we had to do it a couple of times.
Yes.
Because we need to learn.
Because we need to learn darkness. From the difficult history.
You don't have a gut. You poor boy, you don't have a gut.
Yeah.
All right. Hey, we'll see you next time. Happy travel. Good night, Lisa.
Good night, Rick. Good night, everybody. Thank you. See you next week.